Thank you, everyone, so much for being here. It means a lot to get so many people out to hear Peter speak. So my name is Lawrence, and I'm with the Toronto Tool Library and the Institute for Resource-Based Economy, which is the Canadian nonprofit that runs the Tool Library. And IRBE, as we like to call it, it was born in around 2011 in a very special house. This house was called Z House. And Z House was there as a result of a bunch of people who watched a documentary back in 2008, 2009, and were inspired by an idea. They met up at these different chapter places around Toronto and decided, hey, we want to join this movement, this Zeitgeist movement. But we wanted a place where we could do frequent meetings, we could host people, and we could start to sort of together create and envision what this sort of new vision would look like. So we got a house together, and that house, we had 5 bedrooms, and at its height, there was 13 people living there. It was really chaos. 2 bathrooms, which is not enough for that many people. But it was a very special time, and I got to meet there myself, like lots of people that are lifetime friends to me now. And really, like, the Tool Library is a direct result of us seeing the Zeitgeist movies. And it's been a wonderful journey, and we're so happy to have Peter here. Of course, no introduction necessary. He's an activist, an author, and a filmmaker. Thank you very much, Peter, for being here. I won't take too much time, and hand it over to Peter now.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate seeing so many faces. This is amazing. I came here, my intent to come to Toronto in general was to go to the North American Basic Income Guarantee Conference that happened over in Hamilton, and I was fortunate to be invited there and to speak with so many great people that are continuing the exact same train of thought. And it's great to see this bridging starting to occur over the past 10 years. Who here is familiar with the basic tenets of the movement and our train of thought? All right, well, I'm gonna leave. Well, actually, I'm glad to hear that, because what I'm going to do today is very different from the droning hour-long lectures I've done in the past that try to encapsulate everything. You know, I've done about 20 of these things over the past 10 years, and I want to do something different. This particular presentation was done for Z-Day 2018 in Berlin, Germany. Excuse me, Frankfurt, Germany. And unfortunately, the audio was recorded kind of poorly, so I was like, this is a great opportunity. I'm going to be able to do the presentation again and get it done in a good performance quality. So it's kind of inadvertent, but I think you'll enjoy it. But it's a little bit different from the general movement stuff, so lots of time for questions at the end. Anything that seems foreign in this presentation, make a note. And I'm very exhausted, so if you want to ask me really complicated questions, you can make me look like an idiot probably pretty well. But here we go. The relations by which terms are related are an integral part of the terms they relate. That's a really spooky sentence, and it has to do with what is in between the things that we recognize. And it fundamentally is based around something called systems theory. I wrote a book a number of years back. I've written 2 books, but one book, the main one for the movement, at the very end there's a big detailed outline of economic calculation, put in symbolic logic language to be consistent with more economic theory. And it's kind of a crude outline of what the formation of the new economy would be. What I wanted to do here is look at the internals of this based on something called cybernetics. It's the fundamental referent theory, if you will. In my opinion, there's a subject of elements to it. But when I learned about this years ago, and I finally learned more about it, this has so much wonderful information that needs to be applied to any kind of systems thinking, but specifically systems of economy. Merged large-scale systems of economy that actually work as one system, not what we have today. And what I want to do is give some history about all of this and then talk about the inferential elements of it. Then I'm going to have kind of an example of what happened in history with a man named Stafford Beer and the Chilean government in the 1970s. So anyway, in 1948, a mathematician named Norbert Wiener, working at MIT, wrote a very impactful book that none of us have ever heard of called Cybernetics, or Control and Communication in the Animal and the Machine, with the general definition of cybernetics as the science of communications and automatic control systems in both machines and living things. Don't worry, it gets easier as I go along. Stafford Beer, who will be talked about later, as I mentioned, is probably one of the most famous proponents of cybernetics, and he reduces it slightly to the science of effective organization. A little bit easier. Yet definitions morph based on who you're talking to. Anthropologist Mary Catherine Bateson, who's actually the daughter of Margaret Mead, who is also a prominent cybernetician, takes a different angle in her writings, and she says, "Cybernetics is not an academic discipline that belongs in a department. It is an attempt to correct an erroneous way of looking at the world and at knowledge in general." In fact, I find it really interesting to hear different people, how they've defined this science over the past 70 years, because different areas of research actually generate different definitions based on context. It's fluid, and it reveals just how encompassing this field actually is due to its interdisciplinary nature. From 1946 to 1953, there were 10 cybernetic conferences, mostly taking place in New York City. The stated aim was to promote meaningful communication across scientific disciplines and restore unity to science. That's a profound kind of idea when you think about all the fragmentation we have in academia, sociology, physics, biology. They said, you know, all of this goes together. If we're going to understand nature, we have to put it all together. They all came from diverse scientific backgrounds to, among other things, better understand how their fields fit together as a single discipline, as I said. And to give a sense of how advanced this thinking was, the very first conference focused on cognitive science as a middle ground, if you will, including such themes as self-regulating and teleological mechanisms, simulated neural networks emulating the calculus of propositional logic, anthropology and how computers might learn how to learn, and other extremely intense ideas of merging different disciplines and thinking about how they evolve together. This is just amazing for 1946, again, because it's the year that the very first computer was created, the ENIAC, that giant computer. And these people immediately knew what the computer symbolized as a cybernetic organism, as it were. Go, you know, anthropology as related to how computers might learn how to learn. That's really forward thinking for this period of time. Now, within this group, few people stood out prominently, such as Stafford Beer, who today has become almost synonymous with cybernetics, along with his viable system model, which we're going to talk about more so in a second. But let's begin by quickly considering the contrast between reductionist thinking and systems thinking. Stafford Beer brings up a notable reference for reductionist thinking by invoking Aristotle's famous principle of non-contradiction, which simply says, something can't be something and not be that something at the same time. So if the proposition A is B, if that's true, then the proposition A is not B can't be true in the same context, obviously. And this manner of logical thinking is the basis of our deductive reasoning. We use it all the time innately. And it has naturally led to, you know, good solutions overall in terms of pocket development, understanding academic disciplines, and so on. But the problem with this level of thinking, which I actually believe is kind of inherent to the human mind, if you will, it's like a cognitive bias that we have to fight against, is it implies that nothing really overlaps, that everything is just divided and kind of linearly hierarchical, if you will. So the universe just becomes a series of parts, a collection of objects, when the universe is really a collection of systems. System within systems within systems, and the dynamics are very, very different than what is implied by our traditional oversimplified cause and effect deductive reasoning. Hence, it's no wonder, again, as we've divided the intellectual world into parts, like everything else, biology, chemistry, physics, and so on, Stafford Beer has a great joke. Does God see separation between biology and physics? He probably wasn't religious, but the point is, in a holistic sense, these things are what we've created to divide the world up. They're artificial constructs. Nature doesn't see it that way. These are what I call categorical assumptions. And categorical assumptions is what the mind basically does, once again, innately, to try and make sense out of reality, breaking it up. And this general epistemological doctrine and mentality has dominated the way we see the world, the way we see each other. In the same way, in fact, if you look back at old religious beliefs in political economy or just general philosophy, how that dominated, you know, the Middle Ages and very long periods of time. And then we work to develop science in a reductive approach. And now we have to develop a new integrated science. So anyway, systems science, in contrast to reductionism, highlights how things are related. Instead of seeing this noun in noun, let's start to see nouns as verbs, poetically speaking, to invoke David Bowen. And one characteristic is emergence. Nature, again, is not a series of objects. It's a giant vortex of systems, and those systems interact to produce outcomes that are not present in the sum of their parts. They produce outcomes that are not present, they're not indicative by the sum of their parts. It creates new levels of output. And it's extremely important, and it's a stark contrast to reductionism. Likewise, this emergence always moves from a state of simplicity to complexity, riding the wave of the second law of thermodynamics, if you will, entropy. And this process has brought systemic changes that are no doubt incredible, and the most notable, of course, is the birth of the universe and the rise of life itself. If you think about it in terms of a move from relative simplicity to relative complexity, it's quite stunning. So the Big Bang happens, right? However it happened, we know something happened. We know helium and hydrogen danced around with gravity and electromagnetism. Stars consolidated. They eventually died and exploded. They produced the chemical elements of our periodic table, more things to work with. These new elements formed dust and rocks, eventually planets. And eventually a planet called Earth finds itself right in the perfect Goldilocks condition between the sun. And eventually DNA molecules emerged. They broke and formed, and giving rise to single-cell organisms, multi-cell organisms, and after a good while, our mammalian descendants started to give way to brains, and then humans to really interesting brains, the extension of the prefrontal cortex, to our nervous system itself, which is the most complicated thing in the entire universe. We are embracing the most complicated structure ever put forward. And it doesn't stop there. So this capacity for human intelligence and consciousness leads to language, sharing knowledge, the group mind. And we start to understand ourselves more rapidly, exponentially, because it's literally a collective consciousness building upon generational time, more information, lateral sharing, building thinking machines now, AI. We're building things in our image now. We're increasing the entropic complexity that's being output, so on and so forth. We can only imagine really what's next, frankly, in terms of this large-scale process that is one giant systemic process. So all this incredible complexity from basically a few raw materials popped out of the womb of the ether some 14 billion years ago, within all of this systemic emergence, we find shared properties. There are rules to this unfolding organization, as you would imagine, repeating structures that we can recognize and hopefully learn from. And system scientists who have taken on the analysis of this incredible complexity have isolated some basic principles or laws that seem to be shared universally. Laws of how life naturally organizes itself, reproduces itself, morphs, and it's seeking to apply that knowledge to other areas of study, notably social organization. The question is, ultimately, how can we use nature to better understand and create complex systems that have the same integrity and adaptability of nature's native systems, say like an economy? Or put in terms of cybernetics, how do we create what's called viable systems once again? Stafford Beer, looking for an answer, considered the human nervous system as the ultimate referent to try and emulate what's actually happening in terms of control and adaptation. Our system maintains homeostasis or balance automatically when it's faced with problems. It controls your blood pressure. It controls your temperature if you're hot like I am right now because of your terrible humidity. And what Beer found, building upon the work of many, is that there are a number of characteristics that are present in every kind of living system, and every kind of man-made system that actually works. And the presence and proper calibration of these features determine whether or not it's going to be viable or effective. So if we're going to make man-made systems, we have to have a proper referent to do it right to make it actually functional in the long run and have less negative artifacts or externalities and so on. So first, and most broadly, a viable system actually has a high degree of autonomy. It's not fully autonomous, of course, as nothing is in nature, but it contains internal mechanisms that regulate its own behavior, like the human body. And the more autonomy it achieves, while still existing in balance with its environment, the more viable it is. So the second issue, viable systems are what's called recursive. In other words, every viable system contains other viable systems and is contained by other viable systems. So they're inside of each other, like the dolls that you see, with the dolls inside the dolls inside the dolls. Recursion is about self-reference. Living systems show recursion as the system undergoes this emergence or evolution. Man-made systems show recursion through how they are designed, as I'm going to touch upon. In nature, fractal geometry and self-similarity is a good example, where you see a tree, and the tree grows in a pattern which kind of looks like it's creating other small trees or branches. While the leaves, of course, have veins, if you will, that also share the branching pattern. Or this type of thing here, where it's a very large scale view of land, and then you compare that type of structure, you see the recursive self-similarity. You can't identify scale when looking at, say, a coastline from above. You don't really know how far you are. Or a spiral galaxy vortex of the Milky Way seems to be quite similar to things like tornadoes or just water going down your sink. This recursiveness is everywhere. And what it means is nature is just repeating certain processes over and over and over again. By the way, I have this book to recommend, since I know most people have never heard of this word recursive or recursion, and it's actually a very complicated thing to define, believe it or not. But I do recommend this book. Third, a viable system's autonomy is supported by self-regulation through positive and negative feedback loops. If you're not familiar with that kind of terminology, it's actually pretty simple. But this is what helps create the inevitable homeostasis of that given system. Again, like the human body regulates your temperature. A positive feedback loop, also known as a self-reinforcing loop, amplifies a given process. It's doing the same thing, getting bigger and bigger and bigger, something moving out of control. While negative feedback works to self-balance going back into the system, constantly working to correct any of the excess or problems that emerge. And it happens automatically by automating, so to speak, the adaptation of the system to its homeostatic state. A great historical example of this in machinery, a notable one of the first, it's very commonplace now, we do this stuff all the time in engineering, but this is one of the first, is the Watt governor. It's a simple device that would reduce the speed of a machine automatically based upon gravity. If the machine begins to move too fast for stability, it corrects. Here's Mr. Beer, who's giving a presentation about these kinds of ideas, explaining the Watt governor. Notable how systems, true systems, don't need to be regulated. They regulate themselves. Which, think about that in terms of our social system and economy.
The important thing to realize about systems is how they are controlled. And we must get rid of any notion straight away that control is something imposed on the system from outside. It has to be built into it. Now, you saw me operate this governor just now and noticed how the engine slowed down. Let's see how the mechanism works. Suppose the engine is racing, then the governor flies open like that. You see it lifting here, transmitting the message along here, lifting that cam up here, and then shutting off a valve there. That is built into the system. It's called feedback, and feedback is ubiquitous in control systems.
In control systems is what he said. Now, that might seem like a kind of an abstract thing to show, simple machine mechanism that gets pushed to a certain point and it corrects the machine by nature. It's in balance with itself. But this is precisely the kind of thinking that needs to be applied to social change in terms of how we organize society. Do we need tons of increased security, police and military and law out there? If we have all of that, clearly something's wrong with the system is what is implied here. And there's a lot of thought that can be put into that very notion. It's very, very important. And fourth, building upon the prior system of feedback, is the system must conform to what's called, in conjunction with the author, Ashby's Law, which is the law of requisite variety, which says only variety absorbs variety. Put another way, the variety of the regulator has to match or exceed the variety of the system. Variety means complexity. For example, in a country's central bank, Canadian system is pretty much the same as the US system. What do they do when they're regulating the monetary system? They're pulling these little levers, raising and lowering interest rates, along with a very small number of regulatory features that don't really help anything at all. The complexity of our economic system is vast, as you know. So how could you expect there to be balance within the system with these tiny little mechanisms that really navigate and control only small aspects of the complexity? So you have to match the complexity if you want a system to work. Otherwise, you get what we get over and over again, especially the U.S. monetary policy, is crash after crash after crash after crash. You know, we see this historically, the constant economic bubbles, depressions, and so on, credit crunches. It's because they don't know what they're doing. Those policies do not come close to understanding the vast amount of complexity or variety being generated by the financial behavior itself. So what does regulate it? What is the negative regulatory feedback that would correct human economic imbalances? All this suffering and home foreclosures, that's actually the corrective mechanism. That's the negative feedback that we have in society, is the need to bail things out, is literally losing your home, is literally the crash of Main Street and Wall Street. Criminal prosecution, increased government legislation, draconian laws put forward. This is, unfortunately, what we do now in the world to correct the shitty system that we have. So Ashby's law is about the proper response and adaptation. A viable system's viability is measured by how well it does this. Since this idea is so important, I want to give another contextual example as related to the Zeitgeist movement. Let's consider the rise of market economics itself. Let's consider the rise of market economics. Oh my God. I'm fired. I can't talk anymore. Let's consider the rise of market economics itself as a single system after the Neolithic Revolution. While crude, the system appeared viable for some time. Its core functions of labor specialization, trade, resource exploitation, the idea of working capital, this stuff worked with instability, but nothing like what we see today. Regulation was minimalistic, since farming and handicraft good production and trade were very slow, simple processes. Very limited amounts of damage could be done. However, like the discovery of oil, which was extremely impactful, of course, for the time, you know, incredible what we did with the discovery of oil, but like the market system, it faces future adaptability problems. Burning fossil fuels is now destroying the atmosphere, polluting the environment to the extent that we simply can't keep up with it. We can't keep up fixing it with the negative feedback loops at the same rate. So the only management solution is to simply stop using this stuff, since the environment certainly isn't going to change its mind. So that same thing applies to the market system, which, since the Industrial Revolution, is now faced with a new environmental condition with adaptability requirements that stand in stark contradiction to the market's inherent behavior. Capitalism today simply can't adjust itself properly unless the system evolves into something that basically isn't capitalism by any form. In other words, you can't have an economy based upon economic growth, cyclical consumption to power jobs, you know, buying more is better in the value system, when a declining ecosystem clearly demands that we actually reduce consumption, we reduce growth. These are really important things that have to change, and the leadership and business elite, they're looking the other way because this is what their system is. So, and of course, the chain reaction of any changes are going to be political chain reactions. So you see there's just dead quiet in terms of recognizing these things. And that's why most of these problems are called market externalities, if you're familiar with that term. They're not registered. And as an aside, there's a study that was done of the top industrial producers in America, and it tracked their market externalities and the cost of all the things that go wrong. You know, pollution, environmental destruction is the most important part. And there's some other things that relate to human health that were also tracked. And they found that literally the entire economy isn't profitable. If you take into account the damage done to the planet and humans, and what it costs to fix all of that, no company on the planet is basically profitable. So it's out of date, no longer compatible with the planet. It can't adapt. It can't adapt. It doesn't have the proper requisite variety once again. Hence, capitalism isn't viable as a system. And by the way, I strongly encourage that if you find yourself, you know, with this hideous cliche debate between someone yelling at you that you're just a socialist or a Marxist, and they create this duality as if that's all there can be in this boxed categorical thinking once again, I suggest you throw this perspective at them. It's not about isms anymore. It's about what works and what doesn't work. It's about what's viable. And this is the conversation that needs to be put forward from the ground up. It's technical. It's very hard intuitively to grasp this in the way that's required. But I want to put this together, you know, just for the sake of it, because I think it's good seeds to plant in terms of the Stafford-Beer version model of the viable system. Putting it all together, every viable system, whether it's a cell, the human body, a car production plant, has an environment, an operation, and management. For example, a person's brain is the management, the body is the operation, the habitat is the environment. In terms of variety or complexity, it will generally be the case the environment will have the largest amount of variety, and that makes perfect sense. So that means communication channels between these three elements of the system will need to dynamically adjust to how feedback is received and transmitted, as per Ashby's law once again. What I mean by this is information flow can be enormous for any complex system, and there needs to be a way to filter out information. That's part of the process. You have to reduce the variety in a strategic way. The human brain, the manager of the human body, does this by prioritizing needs of the operation, the human body. Likewise, the information of the environment is generally even more complex once again, so the same kind of thing is applied where your habitual perception starts to change as well. So we're filtering out things that aren't relevant to us best we know, and that's what keeps sanity in a given system of vast complexity. Hence, this circuit of communication, showing Ashby's law of requisite variety via this feedback schematic. And again, since this is tedious, if you want to learn about more, I strongly suggest looking up Rosh Ashby's work. And one thing he did to symbolize all of this early on in the mid-20th century, he invented the homeostat machine. And it applies all these principles to keep the machine in absolute balance amongst complicated conditions. Time magazine at the time, in 1949, actually described it as the closest thing to the synthetic brain so far designed by man. That noted, you may remember that rule that viable systems exist in other viable systems and have viable systems within. Hence the principle of recursion. Once again, remember a cell, an organ, the body, the habitat, these are recursive in how they operate. This diagram shows one system with three subsystems or levels of recursion. It also shows five processes of the total system that further regulate the collective system through feedback. And I'm not going to go through all of this. It's too tedious. So I want to talk about this project that Stafford Beer put forward in 1971 when he was hired by the newly elected, democratically elected, president of Chile, Salvador Allende, to build a cybernetic system to assist his new economy called Project CyberSyn. Basically, when he took power, actually, I take that back. Isn't that terrible how our turns of phrase imply things? He didn't take power. He was actually democratically elected. But if you were to read Western literature on it, because he was eventually overthrown by the CIA and other factors, dying in the process, they would assume he took power. He nationalized all the industries, and he wanted to create a homogeneous, I'd say synergetic and unified way of understanding the entire nationalized economy. So he hired Stafford to do this. And I wanted to actually have Stafford himself, in a video that I found, actually describe how it kind of happened.
Monitoring the homeostat that connects 3 and 4. That's how it was. Now, the story that I want to tell you began in 1971, in the middle of the year. I had been going around using this model that I have explained to you in big companies, in agencies, in all sorts of places. And then I suddenly got a letter which very much changed my life. It was from the technical general manager of the State Planning Board of Chile. Remember, 1971, President Allende was in office. He remarked in this letter that he had studied all my works, he had collected a team of scientists together, and would I please come and take it over? I could hardly believe it, as you can imagine. But this was to start me on a journey which made me travel 8,000 miles over and over and over again. I was commuting between London and Santiago for 2 years. While that model of the viable system's in your mind, let me tell you what happened when I first explained it to President Allende himself. Allende was a doctor, a medical doctor, as you may know. And therefore, it was very easy to explain the model to him in terms of neurocybernetics as the way of controlling the body. And then I went into the business of controlling the state. And so I said to him, let us suppose that these elements of the state are the big departments of state, like the foreign affairs and the economy and home affairs, so on. And then we'll have those, and the following things will happen, and then we must have a system two, and I built it up on a piece of paper lying on the table between us. Then a system three and a system four, and I got that far. And then I got to system five, and I drew a big histrionic breath. And I said, I was going to say, this, compañero presidente, is you. Before I could say it, he suddenly smiled very broadly, and he said, ah, System 5, at last, the people. That was a pretty powerful thing to happen. It had a very big influence on me. I can't go into that aspect, the political aspect, in this program. It's not what it's about. But I'm sure you'll bear in mind that I don't have to go and work in places where I don't want to be. That we mobilized, and now we can look at a schematic of it. Here we have it, the whole 3,000 miles, all coming to a telephone switchboard on a daily basis, all this information, going here to the cybernetic network center, which can handle these data using, of course, a computer. Now, I have been very much blamed for doing this, and I resent the blame I've had very much. I've been told that I centralized power for Dr. Allende. This isn't the case at all, as I'm going to try and show you in a minute. These data were not used in an autocratic fashion at all. They all went to one computer because we only had one computer. And if you've only got one computer, then ipso facto, you're centralized. But we were not centralized in the political sense in which this has been taken up by some critics.
An excellent video that you can find online. And he goes through much more detail in terms of how he approached it. I want to note that the Soviet Union, while there were certain variants that happened, they had a hideously bureaucratic system, naturally hierarchical. And this is in complete contrast. This was system overlap. Obviously, you have a certain level of overlap when it comes to how you control and start to manage, but it very, very different in terms of the viable system model that actually took a democratic account, but also preserving the integrity of the system as a priority. So Stafford Beer and Allende disliked greatly the Soviet Union's work. And this project was very, very different. It's really sad because it's a footnote of history. Cybersyn never made it out of the preparatory stages when the CIA-backed coup occurred. And I love this shot. It says, U.S. is keeping hands off. And of course, it was declassified later that the U.S. was very much part of it, as they were with many overthrows in Latin and South America. And they destroyed the control room that we saw, that unique space-looking thing that was actually kind of tongue-in-cheek when they designed it. And the managers were in prison. Stafford Beer had to flee. And, of course, the new government went back to capitalism and so on. So while it was a primitive experiment, if you will, and certainly not with the intent of what we call a resource-based economy exactly in terms of what they were doing in the framework, Project Cybersyn has so much great information that we can learn from in terms of actual social management, especially economic management, that I really want to plant that seed. Like, imagine if we had the advanced technology we have now with real-time information, and we apply the same type of system. It'd be stunning what could be done. So if it wasn't for the force of capitalist hegemony, which was clearly behind the overthrow once again, the world might have actually witnessed a new economic model. So anyway, new model of industrial economic organization, inspiring a revolution of design, science, and economic democracy on a global scale. That's what could have happened here if we had actually let it come to fruition. So I'm going to end there. I hope that was informative. And now we can have questions. Or actually, I take that back. Now we have some other speakers that are going to come up. But thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Not yet? Okay. So to continue, I just wanted to share with you that I'm one of the people who brought Peter here because of the Basic Income Conference. And the reason I did that is I remember being very inspired and excited by the Zeitgeist movement when it started in Toronto. I was really excited because for the first time in a very long time, I saw a whole bunch of people actually doing something and, you know, looking towards a view for a better future, which is a very rare collective thought process. So I was very happy about it. And then I saw Peter recently online talking about the basic income, and I'm very involved in that movement. Because as somebody who's trying to develop climate resilience in an urban community and make sure it's community-based and all of that, I've been painfully aware that we need time if we're going to adapt, if we're going to create new systems, if we're going to do anything differently, we need freedom and time to do so. So to me, basic income is very important. And I think Peter saw a similar potential in it. So that's how we ended up getting together and bringing him here. And I just wanted to mention that, you know, this is something that's actually happening in this province. So we are in a place and a time and a society that may be able to actually begin to take this leap. And that's very significant. And I want, as we talk and discuss all this, to keep in mind that this is really happening. This could really happen if we collectively, and I know Zeitgeisters of all people, will get that and be able to do it. So I just, we're really happy that we're all here and he's here and we can actually think about this. So thank you.
I really see the world through stories because of my background in film studies and the work I do in social media. And I would argue that, for me anyway, the Zeitgeist movement was like that pin. So for my entire life, ever since I was very young, I understood on an intuitive level that there was something wrong inherently with the system. It felt very painful for me to exist in the world and to see all the problems that were existing. And I found that a lot of the adults in my life couldn't see it. So I would challenge them and get them to think about it a little bit differently, and I was always met with them not being able to see. And I think that for a lot of people, when the Zeitgeist films came out online and went viral, there were a lot of people that were ready for those films, as I'm sure all of you in this room were in that camp. But there were other people who were not. And so as I joined the chapter and got involved in Zeitgeist Toronto, and you know, we were holding these town halls and talking about the issues and exploring you know, what the system is and why it is causing all of these problems that we face, and how we could kind of imagine ourselves out of it, it really became apparent that talking about the issues with people was not necessarily getting through to them. It's like you just came up against a wall. It was too much for people. So that's where I think, as a team, we became interested in exploring a way to get around that barrier. Peter often talks about film or art as a way to sneak around the ego, kind of get in the back door, where people are just kind of in a different mindset. So they don't feel like they're being pummeled with something, especially something negative, like the stuff that we talk about. A lot of people interpret all of these topics as very negative, and they have a hard time navigating them. So what would be a way for us to help people sneak in the back door? So what I would say is that the root socioeconomic system that we have right now is actually a form of storytelling, and people are locked into that story. They can't see outside of it. And so that's what I think we need to do, is we have to help people see outside of the story and imagine differently. So I'm just going to read a quote briefly from Peter's book, The New Human Rights Movement. Plug, everybody. It's amazing. You should get it. So from that premise, the architecture of not only the economy, but of society itself has been derived, again rooting back to trajectories set in motion from the Neolithic Revolution onward. This root socioeconomic orientation then justifies competition, self-interest, hierarchy, inequality, and oppression. It is important to make clear that the economy is not some secondary institution that is only engaged when needed. Rather, economic decisions permeate virtually everything we do. And then he goes on to say, put another way, a thought syntax is created in which people narrowly navigate life, focused on a contrived game of economic survival. And over time, our brains literally become wired to this dominant worldview. That's where you get what I ran up against all my life with adults, is that's just the way it is. Life is just unfair. You know, why is there a homeless person sleeping on the street? Well, you know, it's just unfair. That's the way it is, without being able to see around it. So I think if we frame the issue in terms of storytelling, we can really see why people have gotten locked into this mindset and can't imagine differently. We really evolved with storytelling. Our brains are wired for it. It gets to the emotional centers, it releases dopamine, it allows the brain to make connections in ways that just giving people facts does not. And in fact, there's a lot of research now that researchers have been doing that shows that facts really don't change people's minds. No matter how many times you tell somebody that, you know, every day in the USA, there is enough straws, single-use plastic straws, used to circle the Earth 2.5 times every day, just in the US. Doesn't matter how many times you tell people that, they're still going to drink out of straws because they're just not, they can't see it. This is because we as a species actually developed in conjunction with storytelling. We story told our way into existence. So I would argue that we can story tell our way out. So this is from the Basic Income Conference. It's a tweet from Scott, who's a basic income influencer. And at this conference, there was a lot of people talking about this. We need to get good at telling the story of the new economy to help people see it differently. So that's where we come to the library of things that we started. We started with the tool library. We have three locations now. And two of those locations include a sharing depot, which is the just more stuff beyond tools. So camping gear, toys, board games. It's a space where people can go to borrow what they need rather than purchase things individually. And I think if you take storytelling out of just the context of, you know, writing books or making a film, you can actually see project-centered activism as a form of storytelling. You invite people into a space to enact a behavior that they're not used to. And it changes the brain in ways that you cannot do by just telling them. So for me, I have a daughter and, you know, we go and we borrow toys, and I can't describe the feeling. You really have to feel it for yourself of going in there and selecting a toy with her to bring home for a week or whatever, and taking it back, just putting it back. It's an amazing feeling. And my daughter is totally locked onto it. Like, she gets it right away. She knows which toys that she's borrowed, and she goes and gets them to bring back and get a new one. Her worldview is already being shifted because of that process. So these library spaces that we have are really beyond the story that we often tell, which is the environmental benefit, obviously, of borrowing stuff. Why on earth would you have a drill sitting in a basement of every, you know, house or apartment in Toronto when drills are only used for, and I think it's an average of 13 minutes in their usable lifespan, and the rest of the time they sit depreciating? So all those resources that are involved in making that drill, shipping it all over the place, and then, you know, disposing of it, it's a waste. So that's the story that we kind of use to pull people in. And it's a story that people can really relate to and that they get. But there's a bigger thing happening with our library spaces, which I'll get to in a second. Through our libraries, we've also been able to pair up with other organizations who are also doing great things. So the Repair Cafe Toronto, we invite them into our space every Sunday at St. Clair, and they repair people's things for free and teach them how to fix them. So I had like a hand steamer that broke, wasn't shooting the steam out, and I brought it to the repair cafe at the tool library, and it took them a long time to break in because obviously they manufacture these things so that you can't get in. But once they got in, it turned out to be just a little calcium buildup in the tube. We just blew it out and it was good to go. So that's another way for people to, you know, think about their stuff differently. Why is stuff so difficult to fix? Why is it built to break? You know, what happens when we start challenging our system and orient it towards longer-term use of stuff, repairing and implementing tax breaks, which they've done in Sweden, on repairs so that it stimulates the repair sector and gets more people repairing more goods and it incentivizes people to repair. This is Sophie. She's a zero-waste blogger. So we also partnered with Sapinetti, which is a zero-waste soap distribution company. So we have them in our spaces where people can come and refill their jars with hand soap, laundry, shampoo, conditioner, and avoid the single-use plastic. So again, you don't tell people, stop using single-use plastic, it's terrible for the environment. You invite them into a space where they can actually act. And through that action, they start thinking, like, why are we using all this plastic? It's unnecessary. Can we ask our governments to build in laws around changing that? And then Boomerang Bags Toronto is another organization that we partner with. We run workshops out of our space, and they take unwanted fabrics that are kind of destined for landfill or whatever, and they turn them into reusable bags. So again, it's like, why are we making reusable bags out of new fabrics when we have all this material out there already that we can just reuse and repurpose and make these gorgeous reusable bags that are then meant to boomerang around the community? So you're meant to like carry them with you and hand them to somebody at the checkout when they're accepting a plastic bag. And again, it's like that in itself is a form of storytelling. You're offering somebody an alternative, and in that moment of action, they get to think a little differently about what they're doing. And then we also run workshops. So I think in our current system, a lot of people feel disempowered. They don't know how to do a lot of things anymore. We're not a hands-on culture. So by inviting them into our space, we get to help people relearn that process. And that in itself is very empowering. Making stuff is empowering. I made a set of hexagonal shelves that I found on Pinterest out of wood, discarded wood. And that, even though I'm not a big tool user, they frankly terrify me. But I made myself do it because I wanted to experience the feeling of making. And it's very different than going out and, you know, buying some shitty made in China shelves. It feels different. And now when people come into my home and they're like, oh, I love those shelves, I get to tell them that story. And they get to start thinking differently about it. So we invite people in on Wednesday nights. It's community night. We let them use the space for free because we have fantastic volunteers that are experts in making. And they help people use the 3D printers and the laser cutter and the wood shop. They can repair stuff in the space. So it's about inviting people into a space where they can actually experience community in a way that's just outside of capitalism's ability, because in a capitalistic society, you don't experience that level of helpfulness. So yeah, I guess it just really boils down to the fact that these spaces that we're creating, while they're beneficial for the environment, I think the more important point is that they generate a story that's outside of that socioeconomic system that we're in. They get people to start thinking about collaboration, open source, community, feeling supported, feeling connected to something that's bigger, and feeling empowered that they can actually do something to change this ridiculous system. It's not enough to just put this, you know, beautiful ideal out there that we're building a new economy and it's going to be amazing. We actually have to do the groundwork. We have to get involved and start shifting things in a new direction. So yeah, I would just say that no matter what it is, whether it's making a film, making a piece of art, starting lending libraries, getting involved in blockchain, cryptocurrency, time banks, buns trading zone, any of these great projects that are solutions to a lot of the things that Peter references in the Zeitgeist movement and in his book, we can really start building that society. And more importantly, we give people a story that they're not used to and that they can then interpret all of these complex ideas through and feel empowered to change things. Like, we got this. We can do it.
We actually met 4 years ago. You probably didn't remember. Remember when you came back to in Toronto? And I think you were at the U of T building and you were doing the meeting there in 2014?
The event that we did, yeah.
The event. Yeah. We went to, it was at a different place, Kensington.
Right. Yeah.
Anyways, I wanted to ask you this. What was it that happened? It's not very clear what this was, whether it was a conflict or disagreement that happened between the Zeitgeist movement and the Venus Project. Mm-hmm. Because I remember watching that, what's his name? Jacques Fresco, that he said he was, you guys had a disagreement, but he didn't say much else about that. Was it? So can you tell us what happened?
I've always been hesitant to expand on that any more than necessary because it's petty. It was a kind of, after 2 years of working with the Venus Project and allocating tremendous resources and such to the Venus Project, they felt fearful of their identity. And they felt like I personally, who was their biggest advocate, who had brought them out and was their biggest fan, obviously, and they felt like I was interfering with some kind of identity that they had. And that I, and in one level, that was my final insult, was that I was trying to, you know, usurp Jock, something like that, as an ego trip. And I couldn't tolerate that. So in a personal level, and I never, you know, asked anybody to stop interaction with them. In fact, we still have partnership stuff that we do. The linguistic team still works with the Venus Project and so on and so forth. So, and I just stopped talking about it because, okay, I'm not want to put any more, do any more damage to any of this. Venus Project has a think tank type of structure. They're not a movement. And that's great. That's Jock's work. That's Jock's life's work. And that should exist as it is. The movement is a linear force trying to do everything possible with every bridge possible with any options we can find to make things happen for the better. I mean, obviously our goal, the resource-based economic model, what defines that train of thought, it's shared to a degree, but I could actually say there are some differences the way I personally think and communicate and the way Jock thought and communicated when it comes to nuances of things. But I don't want to go into that either because it seems like people become competitive when you start talking like that, and I hate that. So I just say, you know, everything keeps changing and moving, and I hope another organization comes along that's even better than the Zeitgeist movement, you know, because there's always going to be a time span for things. You know, it's been 10 years of this, and I'm not going to be mad if someone took all these ideas and made it better. I would never be mad at that. I could sleep finally.
Yeah. Hi there. In your presentation, you talked about the Mr. Beer, he was talking about the fifth system, and the gentleman he was talking to was about people, right?
Yeah.
So just the idea of the recurring system or recursive system and systems working within systems, in what way will people, what role will people have with working in conjunction with that system?
That's a great point, and you can read a whole book on it. What I'd like to do now is actually put it in the context of what's going on right now in the 21st century, because that was a long time ago, the way they were approaching, but basically decentralization, something that is on everyone's tongue now that's thinking, you know, forward. Decentralization, where you have pockets of people that are mostly independent, remember the autonomy property that I talked about, and they are connected to other pockets of people. They're autonomous to a certain degree. They manage their own work. I'll give you an example. Think about an energy grid. Instead of the consolidated energy grid that we have now, you have a decentralized energy grid where people are actually producing their own energy independently on their own structures that they own, at their homes, solar panels, and so on. So they are, in a sense, their own singular system, semi-autonomous. They're still vulnerable to the environment, and they're still connected to others, because what do you do in that circumstance? You connect that viable system of that home producing that renewable energy. Anything that they do in excess of their use goes back into a larger grid with all the other homes doing exactly the same thing. Suddenly, you don't have a centralized energy authority. This has been talked about by a lot of people, by the way. It's not my idea. I mean, Jeremy Rifkin's talked about this, the internet of the energy internet, he calls it. And it's very logical. Eventually, that's the way it's going to be. So that's a great example of it. Did that answer your question? You mentioned the top tier fifth thing. Well, think about the democratic sense of you deciding to have your own energy, off the grid, so to speak, energy world for your own work in your own home. But you're also participating in the larger collective. So you'll probably think about mesh networks with cell phones and the internet. I love thinking about this. So your phone can actually be changed into be it a signal itself. And if everyone has a phone with the same signal going to each other's phones as a big network, you could create a cell phone network without any controlled authority. You could create an internet structure without any controlled authority. No one can flick a switch. No one can control it. No one can censor things. There are caveats. There's lots of things that you could talk about technically, you know. But that's the kind of thinking. So if you bridge all that out, what you have are economic agents that are autonomous, but as pointed out in the model, they exist in an environment where they're trying to, you know, bridge things together to respect that system unity. And they're autonomous at the same time, and they regulate their own little world while it works in that hierarchical levels of recursion, they call it. I'll leave it at that for now, because I can go on a spiral of things. But the idea of autonomous, collective autonomy, so to speak, where everyone's an individual agent, just like your body, your liver, and so as your liver respects the fact that it's a part of your body, and it has its own self-regulatory mechanisms along with the regulatory mechanisms of your body. And the only thing I would add to that is that when you have, say, your own home with that energy grid, you're going to have self-regulating mechanisms in that grid simultaneously that you monitor. So you're in control of that element of the whole node system.
Okay, so this question is kind of twofold. And if possible, actually, and I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name in the purple down there.
Josephine,
this might actually be best answered by you, but I'll ask first. About critical mass, I wanted to ask about critical mass and how we bring about more wide sweeping changes, because obviously, you know, we've got a very politically inert class who's not interested. They're not going to implement changes legislatively. So, you know, strategies for sort of motivating that. And the part I wanted to ask you, Josephine, was you were talking about the basic income conference and how this is actually happening. My big concern is that if the conservatives get elected, that they'll cancel the pilot program and that it won't go forward. So do we have any kind of feedback on that?
First of all, I think they felt a little frightened to say that they wouldn't continue it. So at the moment, they claim that they would. I don't trust that guy, obviously. I think, you know, our first move is if that guy looks like he's winning or he's going to win, we make sure the Liberals and NDP form a coalition, because then we have critical mass to ensure he doesn't get in power. That's one thing. But I will say the basic income is absolutely vital as a means by which people can be freed up to make these changes and change their behavior. Because, for instance, I would love to go and hang out at the Repair Cafe. It's very rare that I can actually squeeze out the time and the money to go and get there, which is really sad, right? And my project work is the same problem. But when it comes to critical mass to make massive change, you have a couple of things to keep in mind. One is that climate chaos is throwing a level of urgency that has never existed before, and it's real, and we can't, you know, well, people can pretend it's not there, but we all know it is, right? Secondly, the dinosaurs who thought there was no future, who grew up thinking that they had to get under the desk and that the world was going to blow up any second, they're aging out. So you need to take hold of the people who are coming into positions of systems power and structural power, and you need to meet with them and talk to them. You need to remember that you pay them to make change. You pay them to change our systems. They are using our money, right? And that's, they're also being paid by us. So that's imperative. And I would lastly say that if you want to get a sense of how that human part of a system, a structural system, can operate in a self-corrective way, this is where human rights education comes into play. If you actually look at the treaties this country signed in our name and then, you know, neglected to tell anybody about it, if you actually look how they work based on the kind of model that Peter's talking about, because it starts off with the notion of self-determination, but responsibility, right. Collective self-determination and responsibility. Institutions, individuals, state, all have the rights and the responsibilities. So now you see that you're having a complex system with a framework of guidelines that you can apply, and of course there's going to be issues and times when they bump up against each other, but we have to stop sitting around and saying, oh, well, let's wait for somebody to bring this into being. No, we already have these systems, we have these blueprints, and we can utilize them. We utilize them in our community organizing, in a very diverse community with people from all over the world, because they get it. It's much easier than talking about poverty or ecological disaster. We talk about human rights, and then we ground it in ecological needs and realities. And in that way, we connect the dots between the ecology, human rights, structural change, systems change, and the ability to finally hit that critical mass point.
Damn.
Yeah, stay with us. You could do my speaking for me.
So actually, well, Lawrence, while you're going to find somebody for the mic, I have a question about your presentation.
Okay, please.
Sure. So this was very theoretical. And so I work with Emily, I work with Lawrence with the Toronto Tool Library, and we're part of the Institute for Resource-Based Economy. And in this presentation, I don't think we heard a resource-based economy once. So I'm interested, has your perspective changed, or should we be renaming our organization?
Well, remember, as I said at the very beginning, I've done so many talks and focused on so much about the resource-based economic model, or natural law resource-based economic model, whatever you want to call it. And this was a variant of my presentation style. You know, usually I'm all-encompassing. So no, I choose to go for the train of thought in description, though. When you start to label things, again, you have that categorical thought problem, and you end up with symbols. And I'd rather avoid the symbols and names and titles and just go straight to the jugular of the train of thought, because that's where the argument is. So does that make sense? I have never changed my view on any of it. There are subtleties, I think, that I've educated myself about in terms, you know, this particular kind of thinking systemically is a little bit different, I think, for example, than the general model of the resource-based economy proposed by the Venus Project. There's actually far more centralization in their original proposal than the decentralized reality that we've become to see so much more robust over the past 10 years. So things are morphing and changing, and as they should, you know, and things will change even more. I mean, we don't know what's around the corner in terms of what that core integral solution will be that will really alter our framework of what's actually going to work and what isn't.
First of all, thanks for the presentation. Thanks for coming, Peter.
I have no idea where you are.
I'm over here.
Oh, yeah. It was God.
I actually have a three-part question and also a word of caution as well. The three-part question, as an activist, the barriers I hit up against most often are, well, that RBE idea sounds terribly, terribly useful, and I think that would suit me down to the ground, but how do we get there? Yeah. I get that probably every 24 hours. The second part is, how do you find hope in all of this, because human evolution is so deathly slow that it's very difficult to actually spot it happening. And I share, and there's only so many times I can share Toronto Tool Library postings and, you know, segment videos of the Zeitgeist series. And what else can I do? What else can be done? And then the word of caution is actually about universal basic income. I've studied this as well personally, and what I can't get to grips with is that if you understand the very basic laws of supply and demand in economics, then you must also understand that if we give everyone, say, I don't know, $1,000 a month, then all the corporations will cotton on to this fact and say, okay, well, a cup of Starbucks is now $15 instead of $5, and a transatlantic flight is now $8,000 instead of $800. And, you know, the cost of rent for a one-bedroom apartment in Toronto will go from $1,000 a month average to $10,000 a month. That's just basic inflation. So given that that's what we already know, how on earth can something like UBI work? And is it not just, you know, the last ditch attempt by rich people to try and keep money relevant to humankind?
Okay, we'll go backwards. First, I agree with the caveat that there is a dire, multi-tiered, I'll put it this way, the general system has so many different externalities that are negative that simply giving people a basic income doesn't solve so many other things that are being problematically caused by capitalism. So there's other things that have to be done, right, obviously. In the 1970s, there was a big credit expansion, and it's because that the economy was so bad, they decided to just give everybody credit and have credit cards, a culture of credit cards, where people are spending back into the system from loans, and that was what was driving economic growth at that time. And that's precisely what UBI could be used for, so to speak, where they're going to give more money into a society that's dysfunctional, that has great inequity, great imbalance, great, you know, 63% of Americans don't have $1,000 in savings. So when you resolve that little bit, you're actually removing a certain degree of angst. You're creating a little bit of placation. That's a side of it, though. So see my point? So you placate people by giving them money, therefore they don't question the system anymore, right? And we have to question the system because there's plenty of other things that are going wrong with the system. There's no one fix for this. But at the same time, if you give people money, you educate them. I mean, that's pivotal. And they can learn and have time and to think. And time to look at all the other problems. They can have sustenance, not have to worry about their job and their family every day like most do, not have the stress of that. And that much time alleviation, I think, is what will allow for the education to flourish and for all the other problems to be discussed. And inevitably, those people will not be placated. They will actually move and be motivated to change even more than they could when they were so structurally oppressed by poverty. Does that make sense? So that's one side of it. I want to let you touch upon that if you'd like to. Would you like to touch upon that? Let me go. Okay, so the second question was hope. Well, and I think that combines with your first question, which had to do with, well, how do we get there, right? You know, that's a part of that process. As I said in the conference 2 days ago, to have hope is really a heroic act. To be positive is a heroic act, because your hope is a feeling. I'd say it's synonymous with being confident that something can be changed, right? You know, we can play semantic games, but that's the way I interpret it. And it's a heroic act to actually stand up and say, yeah, I'm confident we can do this. Even if you're standing in the face in Tiananmen Square of a guy standing in front of a tank, and that's the analogy I use, well, did he have hope Was he confident? But it didn't matter, because he did what needed to be done. And that is a shared value. If we respect ourselves in society, it doesn't matter how many brick walls are built around us. You have to keep that positive focus. There's no way around it, because there's too much at risk. Otherwise, you might as well just slit your throat right then. Because the value of yourself is really so diminished that you're so apathetic and you don't care, basically. So you have to strive forward. And as far as I'm concerned, humans are humans. We're all humans. We're thinking. We're doing things. We change humans' thoughts. We can change society. That's how it happens. The question is, how do we do it? And that goes to your first question. Well, there is a movement. There's multiple movements. It's an educational kind of process at this point. But what I'd like to see happen, and on the heels of all this, is actually a developmental project where a lot of the larger order structural changes that I've spoken of over the years, not just the cybernetic stuff, even though I think that's integral, it needs to be put into practice in research, like through a university system, a university project, excuse me. Imagine all the universities in the world taking on sustainable management and economic sustainability management in this kind of thinking, and they all started to work together to create the actual systems. Because when you look at this on paper, eventually this resource-based economy will be a series of symbolic algorithmic forms. That's the way it's going to come out through computer language and the language of math and science, because that's what's going to be behind it. That's what's going to be under the hood. And that has to be programmed, because you're going to have an autonomous system with all the properties of nature, synergistically, recursive, all those things feed into it, and it has to be designed. So we talk all day about it, but someone has to step up. And again, I've asked people to do this. I did a lecture, natural law, economic calculation in a natural law resource-based economy in 2013 in Berlin. And I outlined this very large symbolic algorithm. It was general, but I think it served its role. It's also in the two books that I wrote. And that's really what I'm focusing on now. And if I had time to break away from all the other communicative things I'm doing, I would try to get people together to start this programming project and ideally get it picked up by universities and get grants for it. And if you set that in motion, it'd be over. I mean, because you would actually have something provably testable, the scientific method would be put in place. You could test it in small pockets. Eventually it'd be applied to a city somewhere and how they manage their own local area. Because I will say what I believe will happen, because of more with less and ephemeralization, eventually technology is going to become so small. Are you familiar with the term ephemeralization or more with less? So technology and processes are going to become so small and so effective, such low amounts of energy and resource use to produce more and more and more, that's not unheard of that you're going to have a society with effectively a small 3D printing style, very diverse, versatile system of production that can produce everything, say, Toronto ever needed. Along with, say, vertical farm systems that do the same thing in terms of food. So everything becomes localized because of the progress of technology. That will happen if we let it. And you shut down globalization as we know it economically, and you start to localize, use more with less, efficiency will go exponential. And suddenly, you know, as an aside, in fact, I was reading the exploitation of Latin and South America. The reason they've been so destroyed is because they never were able to build their industries up enough to be independent. And if you look at the behavior of Western hegemony, that's what they do. They constantly destroy nations and hit them with sanctions to reduce their efficiency and independence. And that is an unfortunate side effect of this, and why on a political level, on a social oppression level, on a human rights level, you have to start getting off the grid as individual communities. Again, going back to her question, you're never completely off the grid. You're a part of everything else, but you want to create that independent, viable system for your community and region, and it builds up systemically, you know, in that recursive sense from there. So that's one idea. So that's the kind of shit I think about all the time. And I think it can be done. It's too bad that we feel that staticness. Anyway, I'll keep rambling. Anybody else want to add some confidence for my friend over here?
So, like, just in relation to that concept of hope and how to foster that in people and get people thinking about the changes that need to happen and how to do it. So the folks that started the Toronto Tool Library and Sharing Depot, we all used to live communally in a house together, my daughter included. And it was a really beautiful experience, like, talk about, you know, a world-changing way of living. But I went out one day and got groceries, and I think I refused a plastic bag because I carry a zero waste kit as an act of defiance against plastic. And it starts a lot of conversations. People are always asking, like, oh my God, what's this bread bag? Why are you putting bread in this cotton bag? And the particular person that I got that day, was angry about this, my refusal of the plastic bag, and she was like, you'll never change anything. This is impossible. You know, it's everywhere. There's nothing we can do. And I went home kind of like bummed out, and I went into the kitchen. I swear to God, one day I'm going to write a book called In the Kitchen, but the conversations that we had in that kitchen were like fantastic. And I started talking to Lawrence, and I was like, man, like, why are people so negative? I can't understand it. And he brought up the point that, you know, like we kind of live in a bubble because we are so engaged in the changes that are happening. And I think that when people start getting involved in community projects, whether it's a group that's, you know, promoting universal basic income, or whether it's somebody who's developing, you know, these big picture technologies like blockchain, the Toronto Tool Library and Sharing Depot, you know, that's all run by volunteers. The volunteers come into the space and run that thing. The more you're involved in those things, the more hope is infectious. So social media is extremely important. Like you talked about the photo of the guy standing in front of the tank, that gets shared over and over and over again. Like it's amplified like crazy. And that in itself is a form of inspiring hope. But I think the change really comes when you get out and you start acting in your community, because people really, that hope is infectious. So that's all I would add to that.
Yeah, of course, you know, in the current status quo, any tool can be misused, any idea can be co-opted. And that's something that we're all aware of. So what's one of the reasons why I'm advocating very much to ensure that basic income is brought in the context of human rights, so that government then takes on its responsibility to ensure rent control, to ensure that, you know, the other parts of the economy don't leap on that and try to suck it dry, which, you know, some will. But the great thing is, you know, rather than, I shouldn't say that. I have maybe once or twice in my life stepped into a Walmart. We can starve the beast, right? We have so much material surplus, and now we have things like the tool library, and like, we just starve the beast. So if they want to charge $8,000 to fly across the ocean, we'll live stream, or we'll take a boat. You know what I'm saying? Like, we feel so helpless, we have to stop being helpless. We are not helpless. I've been at this for over 30 years. I have grandchildren, and it's a struggle to be hopeful. I don't even really think about hope too much. I think about determination. I think about, you know, in warriorship, in a sense, about how I can take my rage of watching your generation and my kids' generation be robbed of everything that we were thinking we were going to have in our future. I take that rage and I channel it into determination. So hope or not hope isn't really relevant to me. It's, I'm alive, I'm a human, I have children, I have to do this. That's all there is to it. And I make sure I have as good a time as humanly possible doing it. So as an antidote to knowing far too much and having seen far too much and actually met some of those people, like face to face, the people who destroyed our nation. I have to live with that. But I'm a human rights defender, so, you know, it gives me a sense of strength, it gives me a sense of being grounded, and we all can and must do everything we can in our power, whether it's a small thing or a big thing, and it's when we are doing things about it, then you have something stronger than hope. You have purpose, and you have the knowledge that you're doing what needs to be done, and that's a far greater strength and motivation than any hope could ever be, in my opinion.
And there was one thing I just remembered about the gentleman's question. He talked about inflation. Now, that all is contingent upon where the money comes from. Does it come from redistribution, from the crazy billionaire class? Does it come from government mass misallocations and surpluses that they have behind the scenes? In this conference, I saw so many different sources of this UBI. It was really quite amazing. And there is, while inflation, if you inject money into a system, the basic money theory of inflation applies. The more money in the system, the more it reduces the value of the money individually per unit. But that's a pretty complicated process in general. If the money is being put to use, it actually doesn't happen like that. And I think legislation, if need be, could put forward to avoid the abuse of any kind of corporation that wants to stick it to the consumer. And keep in mind also that there's a competitive quality too. So unless there's a mass kind of monopolistic cartel where all the coffee shops get together to, you know, go $8 a cup and force everybody to pay for it, they're not going to do that. They're going to want to keep it as close as they can to be competitive and keep, you know, the money, to keep the price as low as possible. So it's not that simple. In other words, it's not an equation of a bunch more money, inflation. It just doesn't, isn't that clear.
Hey, Peter. As a youngling who first became excited and empowered with the Zeitgeist movement when it first began, I paid close attention to the movement, part of which involved watching your interviews, some of your interviews and debates with certain figures. A memorable one was your one with Mark Dice and your other one with Stefan Molyneux, who are both more or less market advocates or libertarian types. There are people who are prone to calling you a socialist or a Marxist, right? So to be brief, in your third film, you and in a few debates that you've been in, you tended to denounce democracy as a means to reaching this your vision. Has your position on democracy changed at all?
Would you mind clarifying what you mean by that? Because I've never denounced the idea of public participation in control of their society and environment. Now, democracy can take on different meanings.
Yep.
I don't denounce democracy in the basic Greek concept of it. What I denounce is the pop culture version of democracy that we have instituted on the planet today. So it's specific to that. I clearly believe that humans need to have, in this autonomous kind of logic as promoted, control and contribution to the world that's around them. It has to be that way, otherwise people get alienated. Even if their ideas are wrong, there is a reason for them to contribute, and the process, if it's working and as a proper referent, will weed out the correct over the, will weed out the right, weed out the wrong, excuse me, over the right. So, you know, if you have an economic democracy, for example, where, yeah, I'll take it to that level. So you have an economic democracy in the future where people are going online and they're accessing shared open source systems that design goods. So no more corporations. What you have is a structure like this. People go on these systems. They have a background in certain kinds of engineering and education. If they choose to, by the way, not every human being needs to do this, but this is how it would work for those that chose to contribute, who are educated enough to program the language that can design goods, you know, CAD, 3D engineering, and stuff like that. So they go on, they produce this. They do it in a democratic open source way because they are engaging all these other designers to try and figure out how to make the best possible good for that point in time. Now, is that the only thing that is in play? No. You have that other level, the environment of the system, where you have to account for the resources. So if you have resource scarcity on the planet, that's clear. You don't just start building things that clearly are going to overshoot those resources. So there's self-limits that are imposed by nature. And if you program that in properly, you're going to have a tight system where people respect the fact that they're always working within the confines of what is sustainable, and they're always going to work within the confines of efficiency simultaneously, because with the birth of AI, you actually have systems now that can look at a design that an engineer puts forward and analyze it for its integrity. They can actually understand if what they put forward matches the math that has been programmed into it. Caveats, of course, you have to rely on the algorithmic programming, the integrity of all that, but we have a world run by algorithms already, and it works pretty well on a basic technical level. I'm confident it would work that way in the future, too. Point being, you have democratic participation within the environment of rules that are immutable and variant and dynamic, and that's why the system constantly updates and tells you and gives you new information. Oh, we're running out of this raw, material in Africa. We're going to have to substitute something else. So then, boom, the engineering team gets on. The engineers know what they need to do. If they want to have this particular utility in a good, they have to find a substitute. And automatic economic balance and homeostasis starts to be created based effectively around the laws of nature.
So this is a question for the master storyteller, and then as a follow-up to Peter Joseph as well, afterwards, you showed us a clip from a movie that inspired you. You mentioned how watching the Zeitgeist films woke you up to another reality, and I've watched all three films. I remember I think it was the last film, at the end, there was this difference between gluttony and people just throwing things away and being wasteful, and then an alternative to it. And it was just touching on a storytelling aspect that was interesting. I've also read your new book, The New Human Rights Movement, and it's incredible. And there's all these leading edge concepts in them that are real in the world today and need to be grounded out and developed. What I think needs to happen now is some serious and effective storytelling. The kind of stuff that blows people's minds, yes. Sends them to the theaters in the millions, makes hundreds of millions of dollars. And I'd just like you to touch on these amazing ideas and how they can be spun and pushed into the mainstream to excite people. And then following that, what Peter would say to that as well.
Yeah, so I would say, like, in terms of the movement, like, I would like to see the global chapters, social media, become like have a unified strategy where that storytelling element is at the center. Because I can tell you from my experience with working with environmental organizations in social media, including the tool library, the stuff that really takes off is the solutions. People are not interested in being told that the system is shitty. Just like in the film where the girl is like sitting there with her hand up, it's like, what can we do? Like, we get it. People are not interested in that. They want the solutions. So the stuff that gets shared off of our page is the zero waste soap and the bags that get made out of reusable fabric and, you know, the powerful impact of borrowing and the community aspect of it. We ran a crowdfund recently because we didn't get a grant and we needed funding for the organization. And it took no time at all. The thing just went nuts. It was surprising. Like, it was shocking. The community that is rallying around this idea loves that solution-oriented stuff. So I would say, in terms of like fleshing out the story of the Zeitgeist movement and where those solutions are hiding, you just start storytelling in a way that is cohesive and comprehensive and consistent. So that would be my answer to that.
Interreflections. The film I can't seem to make. This entire idea of the film trilogy that I'm doing is all live action. It's all psychological. It's a multi-genre piece that attempts to psychologically invoke certain emotions related to the concepts put forward by the movement and the train of thought. And effectively, it's going to work in multiple time frames and multiple levels. It's partly documentary. It's partly extremely... I'd say there's a horror element to it. There's a quality to it where it examines society as we see it today, but I put it in a horror movie context, in part, not that direct. But the three films are going to create an arc, and it shows the movement of society to a new social system. I don't want to give it away as far as how I do it, so I'm not going to give you much detail. But because it's multi-genre, I'm going at every angle of aesthetic that comes out in film. So there's a comedic element, there's a musical element, there's a satire element, there's a thriller element, there's again, the horror element, and then there's the documentary element that kind of underscores the whole thing. It's a sci-fi movie that's based upon cliches that have existed throughout society. It takes all the memes that we've been hearing today from the school shootings to Occupy Wall Street to even the more solution-oriented things like decentralization to blockchain and Bitcoin. All of this kind of stuff, I'm putting this amalgamation to kind of when people walk out of this thing, people are gonna feel hopefully kind of inspired and overwhelmed, but also a fundamental point of the film is vagary. What I firmly believe is that you hit people over the head with a book like I wrote. Okay, yeah, glad you appreciated that. Most people get through about a quarter of it, and their attention span can't handle any more of it. And that's a problem of society and the media as we know, and as social media, unfortunately, it does a little bit of that to people too. Twitter culture can't think anymore. It's like just little fragments of thoughts. I think that has an effect on a lot of people, not everybody. I'm not putting down social media, but anyway. So the vagary element, I explicitly create scenes and things that will get under people's skin through symbology without ever really telling them what it means. And that, I think, is one of the most important things about creative development is you want people to walk away with it by making their own story of what they just saw. And that makes it their own, sneaks behind their ego, and suddenly when they realize something, they realized it. They're the ones that came up with it, not somebody imposing their ideas upon them. And I think that's a powerful level of creative development. That's why music is so great, because music is generally ambiguous, but it has kernels of direct communication, but the gesture and everything that's underneath it, everyone pulls a little bit something different out of it. That's why songs have this life. Like, no one watches a movie 400 times. People will listen to a song 400 times.
Yeah.
So I'm a musician at heart, so that's kind of where my source is. Anyway, did you want to add anything? Okay.
I have two questions. I got a question for Brother Peter, and I have a question for everybody in the room. My first question is, right now, as far as I know, the renowned scientists in the world are working on the quantum computer. And I noticed in your video, you were showing the moment of when one of the first computers were being developed, and you were talking about how important that it was for the evolution of humanity. Well, I don't know if people understand anything about the quantum computer, but right now the computers that we use operate on the speed of light. And they can only do one equation at a time.
Right.
With the quantum computer, it could do multiple equations at a time. So it's going to change our reality and our world exponentially. So I would have a question. My question is, do you have anything that you know or any vision or any sort of relativity that you would have to see how that is going to impact humanity?
I think you kind of implied it's going to change everything in terms of speed. Because what did the computer do? Is it enabled people to actually have time to do other things while the computer crunched numbers. And then you get outputs, and then you build upon that. I mean, everyone's familiar with the exponential increase in technology, you know, like the Moore's Law chip, you know, the biggest computer, and now the chip in your phone is, you know, obviously much smaller and uses incredibly less power, less resources, and yet is 1,000 times more powerful. And that's probably what quantum computing will do to the current digital state. I agree with that. So the exponential curve, it's an information technology. In other words, information is behind all computing. It's information, it's code. If you can convert any problem in society to an information technology, and you can input that into a computer, and then you put it into a quantum computer, you have huge, massive increases in intellectual development and scientific inquiry. So that's mind-blowing where we could end up when it comes to really efficiently using the advancements that are coming in all areas. Does that make sense?
Yeah,
every area. And it still amazes me, like, you, because everyone's like, oh, exponential stuff only applies to computers right now. And of course, people will argue. They say, well, it's going to stop because the chip, you know, can't get any smaller, right? But then quantum computing comes along and says, nope, we're going to go far deeper now. And then you just take all the disciplines, anything you create, any idea, and you put it into that language. It's going to be unbelievable. Human life extension, you know, all sorts of things are going to be resolved if we get past this hurdle that we're currently in. Also, at the same time, though, look at what we're doing. It's the war machine, man, and, you know, all technology gets the war machine first, and we should all be really terrified about what the Pentagons of the world are doing with their quantum developments and what that's going to end up doing. So there's always that double-edged sword. That's the whole Buckminster Fuller livingry versus weaponry contrast. Because do we use this amazing stuff for good and development and livingry, or is it just going to go straight to the war machine and destruction and weaponry? So,
well said. And then that goes into how we need to program technology for the future so it doesn't do just that. Now, my second question is for everybody in the room. Toronto is an Anishinaabe word. It means meeting place. Toronto is a special city. I just learned last night from overhearing conversation, because I have ears like a satellite, that Toronto is going to be designated to be a test site for a smart city.
All right.
So everything I see you present in your presentation is relevant to us. As it being the meeting place, this is the most diverse city in the world. So everyone is coming to this city and gathering around the world. All of our ideas, all of our cultures, and all of our energies are merging. So this is a very pivotal place. It is becoming the epicenter of the world. So my question for everybody in the room is, given the presentation and given the knowledge that we all collectively share in this room, what are we going to do about it? What are we going to do to preserve Toronto as that place? What are we going to do?
That's always the most important question, is what are you going to do about it? I'd like to add to that story. There was a prophecy in this place, in this meeting place, about 500 years ago, and a indigenous woman prophesized that the peoples of the world would come together and begin to heal the planet from Turtle Island. And she made that prophecy here in the meeting place because the peoples of this region used to come here to dialogue and figure out what they were going to do as they were doing their original democracy, which we borrowed and screwed up. So it is, there's a prophecy that this is going to happen. So the fact that we are the most diverse place in the world and we are here now when this has to happen. You asked about hope earlier, and I shouldn't have said hope is kind of irrelevant. That's not really fair. I should say that with blockchain technology, with things like the Zeitgeist movement, in the last few years, the rapid change of consciousness and the rapid awakening of peoples and the speed at which that's occurring is giving me a great deal of strength and motivation and encouragement. So I want to say that, you know, we can take ideas like the quantum computer, like blockchain, like the basic income, and we have to remember that we are the people who have to make it be what we want it to be. And we are in a great position to do that. And we may also end up in 50 or 70 years being one of the last places on Earth where people can actually survive and thrive. So let us not forget that as we're thinking about being a smart city, is we got to feed what's left of the world in 50 years as our climate goes upside down, right? So there's a lot we have to do, but we can do it. The thing that's really hopeful and beautiful is that we are rising to the challenge, and it's happening. And all of you have been a part of that process. So keep that up, keep moving, and don't. One of the ways to starve the beast is don't waste your time thinking and talking about fucking Trump, okay? Spend your time thinking about how we're going to not do that, how we're going to be way better. Right? And how we're just going to make shit happen different. Don't get stuck in the boxes. Don't get stuck in the assumptions. Don't get stuck in the bullshit model of monetary whatever. It never made sense, and it really doesn't anymore. And we know it. So it's those of us who put out these systems and ideas and concepts for people to grasp and to go in and feel and touch that are going to make that shift happen in such speed it'll blow your mind, and I'm sure of it. And I'm old enough to say, like many of my generation do, oh, it's all hopeless, it's too late, it is what it is. No, bullshit. Y'all are going to change it quick, and I know it, so don't worry.
I think we'll take a couple more, and then, yeah.
There's a lot of humans who want to ask questions.
So I guess this is to the whole panel. I'm here. It's wonderful to talk about the advancement of technology and the advancement of intellectualism and all of these concepts that are very heady, but the whole talk tonight, I haven't heard too much about heart and about the expansion of love and the expansion of caring, which I think has to go hand in hand with our intellectualism and our technology. Otherwise, we're too far on the left side and not enough on the right side. And I know that the tool library, and that is about creation, which is right side, right brain thinking and all that kind of stuff, but I think that we haven't really talked about expanding our heart centers so that we're thinking about everybody as ourselves.
You probably can't see me, but thank you for that question. I think heart and compassion at a fundamental level is about including other people in your life. So it's empathy, but it's also inclusiveness at the same time. And I think we can relate it back to the previous question about how do you continue to treat Toronto as a meeting place as people develop it as a smart city. It's the same idea. How do you treat it as a meeting place? How do you have heart in a city that becomes increasingly technological? I think that a smart city, what we mean when we say that is that we are deliberately solving problems, generally with technology. But technology comes in many forms. And we can think of technology as artificial intelligence and blockchain, which have a barrier to entry that isn't available to most of us. But technology, the way that we order ourselves, the way that we organize ourselves and structure our organizations, that's also a form of technology. And so the tool library, that's our attempt to develop a very rudimentary technology of inclusiveness and heart, right? That's how you share yourself with other people, by creating, I don't know, a form of organization that includes people and that depends upon other people. And the more people you bring in, the more you have to share with each other. So that's, at a very basic level, what I think about introducing heart to this. But maybe somebody else has something.
We'll go down the line. Cool. We'll all answer this one, because it's a great open question. My view is what is the condition reinforcing? So if we want a world where people are cooperative and empathic and caring and loving, what facilitates that? Because everything has a precondition. And in our current system, sadly enough, the opposite is generally reinforced. So what I would say is that I think that the collaborative side of humanity, you know, we have sides, we do have a competitive side, we do have a collaborative side. I would argue the collaborative side is actually more efficient and more productive and also more natural to the human condition. But we are versatile species, and when we have to be competitive and harsh, well, we're going to survive, and that's what happens. And that's unfortunately what the system, that's its MO, that's what it does to people's psychology. So it's systemically reducing people's empathy and ability to love. And I think once the chains are broken, then our ability to actually be freely empathic and caring and respect strangers and not be fearful of each other, that will finally be allowed to flourish naturally.
Yeah, and to build on what he said, you know, there are folks working on a variety of ways of supporting and facilitating that. So that's one of the reasons why I'm a human rights defender and educator, because it is like the legal expression of love, if you like. It is, you know, takes the great principles of humankind and of philosophies and puts them into a structure that we can actually utilize. So when we're building organizations that are inclusive, et cetera, we also have to be able to be structured and organized around how we make that really effective. And there's a variety of tools that we have currently that we can utilize for that. For instance, building cooperatives. Cooperatives require self-determination, education, respect, all these things. They're like the organizational expression of human rights. Blockchain technology, which allows, you know, a continual disbursement of accountability and information and smart contracts, et cetera, so that you can see out in the open everything that took place and it can't be twisted or screwed up, is like the technological expression of a system that can allow for human rights to flourish, not through a mediated center, but person to person and indirect, as it can also to our mediums of exchange. And that's why we're also building a time bank. Because the thing about a time bank where people exchange time credits and services and the like is that a person's need actually creates wealth for the person that serves their need. So a person who is ill or tired or old or whatever and can't deliver a service to the time bank creates wealth for those who have the heart to come and help take care of them. And that wealth can then be generated further out into that system. And there's no debt, there's no interest, there's no exploitation. It's a universal value. And what is in the end more important than our time?
Thanks for that, Melanie. Just so everybody knows, I work with Melanie at Waterdocs Film Festival, running the social media. And I just want to say, like, just share a personal caveat that when I started working with Waterdocs, you know, like, I cared about the environment, I cared about water, but through Waterdocs, whose mandate is to make people fall in love with water to the point where you don't see yourself as separate from water. Water is really you. I fell in love with water in a way that is extraordinarily difficult to describe. Like, when I see the stuff now, the images of the disasters that are happening in the water, I feel it in my heart in a way that it's like it's devastating me. So I think in that way, like, environmental organizations like Waterdocs Film Festival and Planet in Focus that are centered around you know, documentaries that are telling these stories and getting them out there, but framed in a way that's action-oriented. It's not depressing. It's like, you can do something about that. That is also really important. So I would say that, you know, films and art are on the same level as things like the Toronto Tool Library and Sharing Depot. Like, I feel a similar way when I go there and I see somebody returning a stroller that my daughter also uses on a regular basis. Like, that feeling of sharing an item within a community, it's really hard to describe, but it just makes you feel like you are connected to something bigger, and that, you know, we're all one, and we all deserve access to all the things we need. And I think building that infrastructure to tell all these stories, whether it's through a space where people are coming in or whether it's through the documentaries and all that stuff, it's all the same. It's all, you know, getting out of that socioeconomic system story that tells us that we're naturally competitive, that hierarchies are natural, that we're naturally greedy. None of that is true. It's just that we're locked into that story. So anything that tells the opposite story is gonna help that heart piece.
There's some people in line waiting for questions. Sorry.
Sorry if I jumped a cue. I don't know what happened. Okay. I apologize in advance because I was actually going to wait and see if there was maybe an opportunity after to maybe meet some people, but based on the conversations that have been coming up, it feels very organic. So I'm going to go ahead and take a chance here at an opportunity. Everything that's been talked about in terms of storytelling, completely agree with. And I mean, I've been a big fan of yours, Peter, for many years since the documentaries came out and Culture in Decline, Waiting on Into Reflections.
Thank you.
And much like the analogy was made with the pin in Tomorrowland, I think the same sort of thing. Like I watched your stuff and I said, finally someone is putting into words what I've been feeling for so long.
Good.
One of the books that is considered canon, I guess, among... I'm a film and television writer, actor.
Okay.
And one of the books that's considered canon is The Hero's Journey by Joseph Campbell. And Joseph Campbell says that if you want to change the world, you have to change the metaphor. So I agree with everything that you were saying about storytelling, and I agree with everything that you are doing with your documentaries. And I have written a TV pilot where I'm trying to take all the ideas that I've been inspired by your work and now put that into a sort of scripted form. And Canada's not necessarily the greatest environment to get new shows on television.
Right.
I'll just say that. So yeah, at the risk of being completely uncouth and a total dink, I did bring a copy, and if you... No pressure. I'm not trying to propose to you on the big kiss cam here.
I'm happy to add it to the stack of all sorts of other stuff.
I'm sure you have a plethora, yes.
In general. But
no,
I'm happy to look at stuff. I always take time to look at materials people give me, not only just to figure out what they're doing, but also to be inspiring. It's just another kind of input for me. So I'll just steal everything that you're doing. And
thank you. Thank you. Alan Smithy, please. Yeah, no, if nothing else, even if it would be possible to, like, maybe shoot an email now and then, consult.
Yeah.
Hey, does this seem like I'm on the right track? And if no, hey, no hard feelings.
Well,
no,
I can do
feelings.
My best. I'll give you that. So I'm happy to, you know. Cool.
Appreciate it. Thank you for your work.
Yeah, thank you.
There's one back here. Molly.
My turn. Okay, thank you. Thank you, everybody, for speaking. But I'm actually going to direct this question to the two women appearing members of the panel. And Josephine, I'm really grateful that you've joined us. And I'm appreciative of your acknowledgement of the land that we stand on and of Anishinaabeg traditions. And my question is related to that. And now that we're moving towards this movement as becoming much more mainstream and institutionalized, especially in academia than it has been previously, is there a difference between what has been talked about today and the way that many societies have lived their lives for tens of thousands of years and continue to fight for the right to live their lives that way? And I guess, what is the danger of it becoming more mainstream? And in particular, is there a role that women have to play in honoring the traditions of the past and ensuring that they always have a place in our future? Thank you.
Well. That's a big one. Yes and yes and yes. I think, of course, there's dangers with anything becoming mainstream because, you know, the dominant elite will immediately try to seize upon it and toxify it, right? It's like they did that with the civil rights movement. Next thing you know, black culture has become weaponized, and the music that, you know, we created to lift us has been used to destroy us, for example. When it comes to the issue of women, you know, I was involved in various waves of feminist movements. And I think, you know, what's really, really, really important to me right now is that I want us as much as possible to break out of every old paradigm we have been dragging behind us. And that includes this gender battle. You know, like, this is a big part of divide and conquer that has been so successful. Right? If you divide the genders, divide the generations, right? Then you have, make sure that you don't have family units, right? It means everybody has to buy their own shit. It's the perfect profit model. It's just logical according to their system. When we break that down, it becomes much more like motherhood logic. You know, like, motherhood has become an insult, right? In terms of intellectual capacity. Oh, that's a motherhood statement. as in naive and stupid. Well, excuse me, I raised 5 children alone, and I resent that deeply, obviously. But my point being that all of what we're talking about, all the things that we are doing, are inherently, by their nature, going to make it better and easier for women to thrive and exist without being, you know, torn into 100 pieces. You're a working woman, you're a mother, you're a this, you're a that, you're a slut, you're a slave, you're, ugh. You know, as we create these new systems, both women and men will be able to evolve past all this imposed gender role bullshit, and we'll be able to have our own meaningful self-determination, which is the ultimate expression of human rights. Not all women are the same. Not all women want to have children. Not all women want to stay home. We all need that freedom of choice, and that's the whole point. And that's why we're trying to make systems that allow for that, because how else can we possibly evolve quickly enough? If we're not able to do our best with what the gifts we are given, with what we have, we're not going to make it. But lastly, I want to say about tradition and ancestry and the like, yes, there are many, many things that I think we're bringing forward into current day that we're remembering from the past, whether it's First Nations traditions or African traditions and the like. And I'm very blessed to work with young people who are doing a lot of really valuable work on that end, because they're recognizing that, for instance, a diverse genetic person like myself or a diverse genetic group of people needs a way to honor ancestry and honor the earth and honor each other in ceremony, which is what humans have always done, without appropriating and without going backwards. And this is something they're really working on, and they've based it and founded it on the idea and the love of water, which is in all of our bodies and is what we all are. So when we remember that and we think about that and we know that we transmute into just other forms of energy, but we're always part of the DNA and the water, right? Then it becomes very easy for us as diverse and different peoples to act like a permaculture garden and work together and help each other.
Emily, did you want to?
Sure. I hope this doesn't derail it. I'm extraordinarily tired, so getting into these like really high level concepts might be a little tricky for me right now, but I think that like what you're mentioning in terms of throwing back to kind of a time where other cultures were already living in this lifestyle story that we're talking about, kind of goes back to the bonobo chimp thing that you mentioned, where, you know, we always talk about chimps as being where we've descended from, and chimps are naturally in these hierarchies and violent and oppressing their female chimps and all this stuff. But we're also actually related to bonobos, and bonobos had developed in this completely different environment, whereas the chimps evolved in a environment where resources are scarce. The bonobos were evolving in an area where resources were abundant, and they had a completely different social structure. They were more matriarchal, they were more caring, you know, the young were cared for by the group. There wasn't this like vicious violence and aggression that was coming up. So I think in a way we're trying to go there. Like we're trying to take our species to a place where this resources are scarce, we have to be competitive, you know, if somebody gets something, it means there's not enough for me. We shift the environment to say, no, like resources are actually abundant, and if we create that culture of sharing, we're already shifting back to that mindset. And then the other thing I would say about gender is it's extraordinarily important, like what you were saying, that this divisive stuff that happens, in light of the Me Too movement and all this stuff, like it's important that all these things come out and we see them in the light and recognize that women are having a hard time in this male structure. But I find that a lot of the narrative that's missing is compassion for men. Because men have also been ingrained in this system. Why are they acting like this? Why are men putting down women like this? Why is rape a thing? Why is there this culture of objectification and violence towards women? Like, we really need to have that conversation. We can't just sit here and say, it's men that are doing this to women. Men have evolved inside this environment just as we have. They've been trained to see things in a specific way. So we really need to have that dialogue, and I'm not seeing it anywhere in the media. So that's like where we can all take that conversation. Whenever these Me Too movement conversations come up, we have to say, hey, but wait a second. Like, these people are not just bad people. They've evolved in a particular environment to understand life in a particular way, and that's why they're acting like that. So how can we change the environment so that men are not growing up in that mindset?
Mm-hmm. That's excellent, thank you. That's gonna be the last question.
Thank you.
very honored to have the last question. I can't believe I got it. But in any event, first thing I want to say is, Peter, I think it's amazing that you're here and having a conversation like this. When I think about the Zeitgeist movement, I see it as a conversation. I see it as an ongoing dialogue. I think conversation and dialogue is really our only bulwark against falling to what I would call the dark arts, which I'll expand on later in this question. And I promise you there is a question at the end. One of the biggest contributions I see that TZM brings to our political discourse, and especially you, Peter, as a spokesman for the movement, or the leader of the movement, really, is the fact that you raise the sanity waterline, okay? And I think raising the sanity waterline is an immensely important goal that we all should have as people who are concerned with our political and social well-being. So in terms of that, what do I mean when I say the dark arts? So from the Less Wrong Wiki, what the dark arts are defined as are rhetorical techniques that are crafted to exploit human cognitive biases in order to persuade, deceive, or otherwise manipulate a person into irrationally accepting beliefs perpetuated by the practitioner of those beliefs. Mm-hmm. Now, when I've seen you engage with critics of the Zeitgeist movement or just getting involved in political discussions, I've never seen you employ these dark arts. I've always seen a strong commitment to rationality, to consequentialism, to focusing on, to borrow from your presentation, what works, right? Being able to have a coherent conversation about what it is that actually works requires a certain amount of rationality and a refusal to engage with sophistry in a general sense. And when I think about this issue and I think about what you've done to raise the sanity waterline, my mind immediately goes to two examples. The first being your video, The Intellectual Dishonesty and Pathology of Stephen Molyneux. That video is, I think, a clinic on how to identify and coherently and reasonably respond to what is blatant sophistry. And that's a challenge we all, I think, face. And then the other example is, perhaps more comically, Louis the Logic Gremlin from Culture in Decline, where you refuse to capitulate to tone shaming and restricting the content of your message and taking it away from rationalistic, consequentialist grounds and into something that sounds better or is butterier or more digestible. Right. So after saying all that, my question to you is, as someone who is committed to these ideals of rationality and coherence and having a train of thought that is defensible in those ways, what can you tell us as aspiring advocates to what do we do? What can we do better, and what can we look for to make our message allow it to overcome the very common dark arts that we run into that people like Stephen Molyneux engage in, or people who would even ostensible supporters of TZM who would try to shame you into changing the train of thought to something that it just sounds better or feels better.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate your comments and observations and compliment. I don't know if I'm that rational or what have you. I'm just whatever I am. Obviously, we're all irrational in different ways because we're emotionally polluted. That's probably the wrong word, but that's just, yeah. So what I kind of think in my mind is there's a signal to noise ratio when you're dealing with a given individual and the ideology or concepts they're putting forward. And you can kind of get to the bottom of it pretty quickly when you talk to people that have no argument, because they instantly move into the dark arts that you talked about. It's a kind of manipulation process. And most people, unfortunately, that you speak with, they're not thinking in terms of convincing somebody of something. They're not thinking in terms of trying to see eye to eye and engage a dialectic. They're looking at it almost subconsciously from the standpoint of somebody looking next to them and figuring out who's right. And that is the pathology of Stefan Molyneux. And that's many like him that are not interested in what is truth. They're interested in being perceived as a purveyor of it. And that is, unfortunately, I think, an outcome of this hyper-pluralism that's become even more politically exaggerated, where, you know, you turn on this is a bad example. Here's a kind of a hypothetical example. It's not this extreme, but. And I also don't want to codify my respect for so-called academic experts, because there's plenty of flaws there too in terms of the trajectory of learning and getting a PhD. I consider it a form of indoctrination in many cases. But let's say you turn on the TV and boom, you have a highly credentialed guy or woman that studied something extensively. They've been doing it for 30 years and they're on this show and they have something to say. They've been working on it. And then the same thing, the split screen, there's Joe Bob from Montana who happens to disagree with what this guy has to say. And this is like some kind of entertainment thing too now. And the Trump reality in the US, which has now taken people that at least were shamed enough down not to stick their head up and act like, you know, and continue the pollution process. They at least had a certain sense that maybe there's something wrong with their worldview, whether it's bigotry or whatever, or nationalist loyalty or loyalty to capitalism and so on, the symbolic blocking of their minds, because that's unfortunately the way most think. They think in terms of symbols. That's why when you talk to people about a train of thought like this, they're like, that's just Marxism. Communism. That's just, they can't, because they're not educated enough to think long enough about it or have the vocabulary, or they're emotionally polluted at the same time. So this, and again, back to the Trump thing, it's a unique quality. I'm not trying to, you know, you just mentioned, let's not talk about it, but it's a unique sociological thing, because now all these people that were under the radar, well, say they're ducking down with their ignorance, they're all alive again, and they're being taken seriously. I mean, we used to have a whole resurgence of all sorts of bogus Nazism and eugenics and general just belligerent bias of groups. So I could probably keep rambling on this. It's a very complicated question you just asked me, but so I look for these things, and usually I can kind of feel it out, but generally speaking, I don't like to debate with the traditional sense of any debate, because right now, pop culture debate is not based on the original Greek concept of debate. It's not based on dialectic, meaning point to point. It's about trying to make an impression and dominate. And that's why generally if someone's like, you should debate this guy, I don't know how many people have emailed like, Peter, you gotta debate Jordan Peterson. I'm like, no. I don't wanna talk to someone who's so fundamentally polluted and has such an ego and now has millions of dollars and followers, there's no way he'll ever turn around and say he's wrong. Right. There's no point. So I think the low-hanging fruit has a lot of value. I mean, obviously we have to counter. We can't just be around the choir. But when you then that's why like the UBI people and just all these great groups, Bitcoin and blockchain specifically, all the people that are kind of inching into this territory, those are the ones I want to bring together. Those are the ones you want to unify. And all the people on the fringe that are throwing stones and poop, you know, they're the ones you just continue to ignore, because they're going to be forced to change regardless. It's not an issue of like, I don't want to respect them, but I don't respect Nazis, for example. They don't deserve, if you don't respect general differences of people in the sense of them being able to live their lives their own way, in with the confines, of course, of mutual respect. You know what I mean by that? Like, if you can't be if you don't have an ideology that supports mutual respect, then you're not in the human club anymore, because that has to be there. Yeah, exactly. So, okay. Hope that helps. And thank you for the good question.
Excellent. Okay, so I want to just thank you. Sorry, we got to cut it. I want to thank you very much to Reg, Peter. Thank you for coming and sharing your knowledge. Josephine, Emily, all the volunteers that made it happen. Everyone, thank you, CSI. Thank you, Oxygen. Thank you, Earth. Awesome. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So, if, of course, absolutely. If you guys wanted to give us a hand, we can stack up all these chairs. That would be hugely helpful. And actually, we got to be out here in 15 minutes and just.